You are what turns the champ.
Green, call Lawn Doctor.
Take me out to the ball game. Take me out with the crowd. Buy me some peanuts and Cracker Jack. I don't care if I never get back.
They're coming alive with new leadership and renewed spirit. The 1980 New York Yanks. The Yanks meet the Texas Rangers as the exciting opening series continues. Tomorrow night at 8:30, Saturday at 4:15, and Sunday afternoon at 3.
Good morning, I'm Roy Whitfield. This is Action News for Friday, April 11th. Topping the news at this hour, a New York cop is shot while trying to nab three robbery suspects in Queens. Substantial progress reported in the transit talks, and President Carter asked U.S. allies to impose their own sanctions against Iran. A police officer answering a robbery call at a Queens social club was shot and seriously wounded Thursday night. Eyewitnesses say the unidentified officer arrived at the club on Beach 43rd Street, Far Rockaway, as three suspected robbers were escaping by car. The officer was shot three times as he gave chase. At last report, the policeman was in serious but stable condition at St. John's Hospital. Although his name has not been released, it is known he was assigned to the Mott Avenue Station House. The officer is the 14th city cop to be shot in the line of duty this year. One suspect has been taken into custody concerning that shooting. A note of optimism this morning toward ending the transit strike now in its 11th day. Jeff Kamen reports on Thursday's meetings held at several Manhattan locations.
Talks in the transit strike are in a critical stage right now. Governor Carey, City Council President Carol Bellamy, and other MTA board members were shuttling back and forth between the Sheraton Center Hotel, where labor and management have been engaging in give and take at the bargaining table, and the governor's office only blocks away, where Mayor Koch has been working on a potential settlement deal with his top advisors. I spoke to him before the talks recessed for the night.
The fact is that we're here without question, Governor, myself, his people, my people, to be in touch with Dick Ravitch regularly through the evening, who is now entering into very important negotiations with the TWU.
Are the indications that things are close to a possible...
No, I cannot say that and then have you disappointed. I can't say that.
Earlier today, Governor Carey, Mayor Koch, and the man on the hot seat in the negotiations, MTA Chairman Richard Ravitch, walked into a news conference at the governor's Midtown office and struck a very optimistic pose. Although none of them would say so, I learned from other reliable sources that progress has been made at the bargaining table. And if the negotiations continue as they have been today, there is reason to believe that a sizable wage increase will be offered to the strikers, based in large part on buybacks, work rule changes yielding increased productivity. But that could be days away. Meanwhile, the mayor and the governor expressed their full faith in Mr. Ravitch as the chief negotiator.
Unity. This is a unity slate. Although we're not running for anything.
In the press room of the Sheraton Center Hotel, site of the negotiations, leaders of the major unions in the city and state joined in a scare tactic, warning of a possible general strike in support of the TWU.
Is it being actively considered? I spoke about it. I spoke about it.
As a potential reality?
As a potential step along the road of our shutting off and bringing this city back to a normal operation.
That would bring it back to a normal operation?
Yes, it would. Yes, it would. Because then the powers that be are going to take note of what could possibly happen, and they're going to have to come up with something reasonable.
Well, I'm told the general strike being considered, though not very actively right now, would be a midday four-hour action. The union leaders called on Mayor Koch to personally come to the bargaining table. I consulted a top labor lawyer and a nationally known mediator on that suggestion. Both experts, not involved in the city dispute, told me the call for Mayor Koch at the bargaining table is nothing but theater. Hopefully all that will be past history if all goes well within the next few critical days.
Long Island Railroad talks are adjourned until later today. Progress also reported there. One mediator says he's pretty optimistic because the seven Long Island Railroad operating unions have been pliable on the issue of work rules. So now it's down to money. With the Long Island still running, some cars from Nassau and Suffolk have been kept out of the city. But rush hour is still a nightmare. Tim Malloy reports on the homebound exodus Thursday night.
This was rush hour number 16 of the strike, and it was a day at the beach compared to the soggy, frantic exodus 24 hours ago. At the 59th Street Bridge, the city's busiest exit point, it was slow going, but the quiet determination that has come to characterize the city's approach to the strike seemed to have returned.
3 p.m., 1st Avenue, 13 blocks south of the entrance to the 59th Street Bridge. The rush hour started earlier today, and it lasted longer, though some were able to make a hayride out of it.
Hey, let's go!
And others were willing to board big rigs for the ride. Most were locked to the steering wheels of their cars for the long drive to Queens and the island.
It's a nightmare. I love New York, but this is a nightmare.
It's crazy. This is crazy. I don't know what the man's gonna do.
Of all the New York bridges, the 59th Street Bridge handles by far the heaviest load of outward bound traffic. It was hoped tonight that its six lanes would carry out about 6,000 cars an hour. 30,000 cars over the five-hour rush period.
See a little bit more horn blowing yesterday and today as opposed to last week. There was a little bit more joviality last week.
They're keeping their heads so far.
Oh, yes, sir, more or less, I say. I would say so. Definitely.
How about you?
Oh, definitely. All the way. We have to keep our cool.
Big problems at the Queens Midtown Tunnel, 25 blocks to the south, brought problems uptown. The long wait for those hoping to board the green bus line was longer today. But the Salvation Army, no stranger to disasters, posted trucks at the 59th Street and Brooklyn Bridges and handed out thousands of cups of free coffee.
We're all New Yorkers trying to help each other out. This is all volunteer work. I hope they're happy to see us here because I like being here helping people.
Now here's one you might find hard to swallow. Because the Battery Tunnel has been made outward bound only during the evening rush, the traffic department suggests you enter Manhattan this way from Brooklyn, Queens, and Staten Island. Take the Verrazano Bridge to the Staten Island Expressway, to the Bayonne Bridge, to the Jersey Turnpike Extension, to the Holland Tunnel to the west side of Manhattan. Take two aspirin and call us in the morning. They say it takes 30 minutes. We say good luck.
The morning rush hour rule is that there must be at least two people in each car which comes into Manhattan. But when a cop working at the mouth of the Holland Tunnel spotted a homemade mannequin, which was propped up next to the driver of one car, he ordered that car to pull over. It was done, but the driver, caught with his dummy showing, quickly waved in a hitchhiker and rolled through the tunnel, all quite legally. No matter what time of day, the transit strike has made traffic conditions in Manhattan almost like a continuous rush hour. As Frank Casey reports, that can cause some problems, particularly for people in a real hurry.
Miguel Chavez got stuck in traffic and ran out of gas on the Triborough Bridge. He was driving his pregnant wife, Juana, from their Queens home to Mount Sinai Hospital. He flagged down a taxi, put his wife in it, and sent her on to the hospital. So far, so good. But what they hoped wouldn't happen, happened. The baby just couldn't wait.
At 116th Street, just six blocks from the hospital, the mother went into labor and started screaming. The cab driver flagged down a patrol car. One officer drove escort to the hospital while his partner did what he could for the mother.
And she was screaming in pain. And I tried to get her on the seat, and I positioned her so I could see what was going on, and I could see the baby's head coming out. So all I could do was just try and hold her there and just hope that the baby, if it came out, came out. But
were you saying to yourself, hold it, baby, hold it,
yeah.
Don't come out now?
Oh, yeah, I was hoping that we got to the hospital in time.
Well, it was 116th Street between Park and Lex to here, and we had to make it in, 1 minute, maybe less. We flew down.
A doctor rushed out of Mount Sinai Hospital and completed the delivery. Take a look at 9-pound, 11-ounce Diane, the so-called 1980 transit strike gridlock baby in the arms of a staff nurse.
The father finally made it to the hospital several hours after the happy event. The mother and baby Diane are just fine.
Six airlines are now competing for transcontinental passengers in this country, and with Eastern Airlines joining the battle for passengers in June, World Airways is offering a very special bargain basement offer starting next Tuesday and lasting for 1 month. one way, coast to coast, forget this, $69.99, or as low as $19.99 if you have a special coupon. The idea is to try to recover from passenger losses from a long strike last year.
If you are still smoking and are looking for a way to kick the habit, we would like you to consider the Petri method of hypnosis.
I stopped smoking.
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 The Petri method is an original therapy of the New York Institute for Hypnotherapy. For information about how hypnosis may be able to help you stop smoking, call 212-428-4372, 428-4372.
Intensifying hostilities between Iran and neighboring Iraq are now spilling over into the 160-day-old hostage crisis. A spokesman for the militant says the hostages' lives would be in grave danger should Iraq attack Iran. This because, according to the militants, Iraq is a puppet of the United States. That warning comes at a time when Iran is sending a naval force to the Persian Gulf near Iraq following fierce border clashes. And in what could be a prelude to spy trials for the American hostages, Iranian television broadcast a film showing what it said were two captives describing espionage activities by the occupied U.S. Embassy. The Iranian broadcast did not say when the film was made, but American officials insist the equipment shown probably was routine radio and television equipment. When President Carter broke off diplomatic relations with Iran and imposed economic sanctions, he also called upon our allies to join the boycott. On Thursday, the president got lukewarm support at its very best. Both the Common Market and the 21-nation Council of Europe issued statements demanding the immediate release of the hostages, but none of our allies said they would join in the boycott. In fact, Japan said it will not support any U.S.-requested sanctions against Iran, which may endanger its vital Iranian oil supply. Without mentioning them by name, President Carter criticized some of this country's allies for seeking U.S. leadership and protection and then begging off when asked to help out in a crisis. Mr. Carter told the American Society of Newspaper Editors that some nations are wary of the obligation of alliance.
Nations ask us for leadership, but at the same time, they demand their own independence of action. They ask for understanding. Yet they often decline to understand us in return.
The president also accused the Soviet Union of appalling inhumanity in Afghanistan. He said he will take legal action if need be to keep American athletes from attending the Summer Olympic Games in Moscow. The president also used that occasion to lash out at his political rivals. Two of the men who'd like to become president were able to counterattack. Ted Kennedy and John Anderson spoke before the same newspapermen's gathering. Details from Scott Barrett.
The man in the White House, Jimmy Carter, has had a pack of howling presidential hopefuls lashing at his leadership ability. In response to the latest Ronald Reagan charge that U.S. weakness caused the Iranian crisis and the Soviet invasion of Afghanistan, the president called the claim ridiculous.
That line of argument that an invasion of a sovereign country with 100,000 troops or the taking over of a compound with innocent American hostages is somehow the fault of the United States or its president is completely fallacious.
But before the same gathering, Ted Kennedy continued to howl against Carter's leadership, not on the foreign affairs battleground, but on the economic battleground.
He is on this issue, at this time, the major direction for leading this country lies at the footsteps of the President of the United States. Just as it did with President Kennedy in the early 1960s, when we reduced unemployment from 7% to 3.5%.
Kennedy says Carter needs to deal with reality, not rhetoric. Republican longshot John Anderson feels the same way, only his party is different. And if Anderson chooses to run as an independent, he doesn't want to form a third party.
I have to decide, in view of what I perceive to be the mood of the American people, the growing dissatisfaction with the limited choices that would be presented by the nominations of President Carter and Governor Reagan, whether or not I have some obligation, therefore, to extend the range of that choice.
Anderson thinks he will draw equally from Carter and Reagan if he runs independently in November. And as for the president, he is still running harder than he was a few short weeks ago. In Washington, Scott Barrett.
Some good news for the consumer this morning. There has been a dramatic drop in meat prices all across the country, plunging to their lowest levels in more than a year. But those bargains could be very short-lived. The government says beef prices will go up in the next 3 months, as will the cost of sugar and soft drinks. Another bit of good news is retail pork and egg prices should be going down in the months ahead.
This is Mayor Ed Koch. During the transit strike, I'm asking everyone who lives, visits, and works in New York City to help make our emergency transportation plan work. Whenever possible, walk or ride a bike. Exercise is good for your health and is good for the city's health, too. Employers should make every effort to provide their employees with places to store those bikes. Group riding and taxi cabs is permitted during the strike. We're trying to bring this strike to an end as quickly as possible. Learn the emergency transportation plan and help make it work. Thank you.
More Israeli troops have crossed the border into southern Lebanon. Israeli military sources say the forces have been sent in to defend against Palestinian guerrilla strikes. The Beirut government is protesting the action and is threatening to call an emergency session of the United Nations Security Council. A protest by Palestinian students turned into a melee in the West Bank when they reportedly started throwing rocks, burning tires, and setting up roadblocks. Israeli troops used tear gas as they carted off about 400 students. In Washington, Egyptian President Anwar Sadat has warned that any Israeli attempt to maintain control of occupied lands is, in his words, doomed to failure. Sadat said the entire Middle East peace process is in danger because of Israeli Prime Minister Menachem Begin's West Bank settlement policy. Here in New York, the city's Department of Investigation says it has videotapes of seven Brinks guards stealing $1 million in coins. Those coins taken from the very parking meters the guards were supposed to collect fees from. Following a 9-month investigation, all seven guards have been arrested and charged with the $1 million theft. The Brinks company has a 3-year contract with the city to collect those parking meter fees. Well, how did you get to work today? That's a question we've been hearing a lot during the transit strike. And as Christy Ferrer reports, some people have found some very unique ways of getting around.
Those are either the people who have been spending the most money, expending the most energy, or using the most ingenuity. To the utmost, New Yorkers have used horsepower, people power, creative power, and good old elbow grease to beat this strike. But for those of you whose energy levels are running on just about empty, have I got something for you. It's one of the only motorized ways to get around town and beat those traffic doldrums. With his motorized skates, inventor Martin Halverson gets 240 city blocks a gallon and his share of choice looks.
Round, get around, I get around, yeah, get around, round, round, I get around.
I think they're great, fantastic.
Would you use them?
Definitely, yes.
I think it's ridiculous.
Why?
Physical walking never hurt anybody.
I think they're marvelous. You can get around without pushing your feet. You just hold a handle down and go.
It's a very simple engine with a throttle, a hand throttle. And I use the hand throttle for speed and for brakes. It brakes on compression.
At up to speeds of 30 miles an hour, Halverson's 1.3 horsepower motor can take any checker in the streets these days, if unsuspecting passengers don't kill him first. It really did happen that way. If you want to get motor rolling, you're going to need $600 to finance the custom-made skates. And the manufacturer advises you know how to skate backwards on the old-fashioned variety before you tackle these.
Well, the big rainfall is over, but it's going to be quite a while before Westchester residents stop feeling the effects of Thursday morning's massive flooding. Parts of the Sawmill River Parkway are still closed as motorists continue to deal with a series of roadblocks and detours. In some areas, the water was 2 to 3 feet deep. People even had a hard time getting to a phone booth to tell their employers just why they were going to be late for work. And many motorists finally had to give up and abandon their cars along the parkway. Drivers weren't the only people who were having some problems. Residents and store owners in Ardsley, New York, were coping with as much as 6 feet of water that seeped into their basements and ground floors. And in the back of an Ardsley A&P supermarket, a retaining wall on the side of a hill came crashing down into the back of a store. The supermarket cement block wall was no match for the mudslide. At about 2:30 Thursday morning, employees heard a roar and watched the whole back wall come tumbling down. They said a meat case weighing at least a ton was pushed 35 feet. Officials say if it happened during the middle of the day when the store was crowded, many people could have been killed. Westchester officials say they will appeal for federal disaster aid for their county area. President Carter's 81-year-old mother, Ms. Lillian, took the stand on Thursday. She was a character witness at the bank fraud trial of Burt Lance. Asked just what she thought of the former federal budget director, Ms. Lillian replied, Mr. Lance is quite a man, as she put it. Good-hearted Edith Bunker of All in the Family fame will die in the show this fall, but her creator will donate $500,000 in her name to the National Organization of Women. Producer Norman Lear says the fund will be used to help support the drive for the ERA. Actress Kay Medford, who appeared in over 200 films, is dead of cancer at the age of 60. Her most famous role was that of Barbara Streisand's mother in the motion picture Funny Girl.
I'm Senator Bill Bradley of New Jersey. Census Day was April 1st, but it's not too late to answer your confidential questionnaire, and your cooperation is vital. Unless all of you are counted, our region could lose millions of dollars in federal aid and several representatives in Congress. We can't afford to be shortchanged. Please help make sure we get our fair share by returning your census form today. Let's stand up and be counted.
We can't afford to guzzle. Gas is not so cheap anymore. Gas guzzler cars, gas guzzling drivers, gas guzzling lives.
Gas guzzlers. Don't get caught. Get the mileage guide at any new car showroom.
Turning now to news in the world of sports, the Yankees took on the Texas Rangers, the Mets faced the Chicago Cubs, as our local teams officially opened their respective seasons on Thursday. Highlights of both games from Jerry Girard.
A nightmare for the Yankees. They lose it 1-0 in 12 innings. Now last year, the last couple of months, Nettles was atrocious at third base, and that's the way he started off the season tonight. I am worried. He looks very shaky out there, and he cost them the game. Now let's look at some of the highlights and the positive side. Ron Guidry, 9 innings, no runs, 2 hits, and the fastball is what surprised me and the hitters. Fastball swung on a miss by Sample. He's looking for the slider, gets another fastball, and then the third pitch is also a fastball, and he doesn't get around on it. Now I was concerned about Guidry in spring training because the fastball wasn't jumping. You hear, see that swinging late, and Jackson gets the pop-up. Now Nettles did make a nice stop in the middle of the game, going to his left, and the Yankees got a scare on this play. Watch the runner. Just as he approaches Watson, the runner's helmet comes off, a million to one shot. The helmet hits Watson in the face and cuts him. Hey, is it going to be that kind of a season? Then bottom of the 13th, Watson's okay. The Yankees load the bases, and Dick Houser pulls a rock. You don't bring in Gossage first time with the bases loaded. He can't have his control. He hasn't pitched in weeks. but he brings him in, should have him come in at the start of the inning. And with the bases loaded, first pitch gets away from the catcher. That's the ball game, 1-0. Terrible start, but it's only one game. At Shea this afternoon, the Mets won their opener 5-2 behind Swan, who went 7, and Allen, who finished up. But not too many were there to see it, only 12,000. This was about an hour before game time, a frightening sight, even considering the transit strike. They poured in about 2 an hour. Thank goodness it was sunny and warm. But the diehards, they come no matter what. And there's something about opening day that gets you to dreaming.
They're a young club, and they got a good future, and I think we're going to do it.
They traded away a potential 280 hitter in Richie Hebner, and they got from it not only a potential 280 hitter in Phil Mankowski, they got a man that could hit 20, 25 home runs in Jerry Morales, plus a good fielder.
Have you been sleeping well lately?
Well, Jerry Morales, with a runner at second base, came up in the second inning his first time as a Met against Rick Rushel. Got the man in. Ground balled into right field, scoring Jorgensen, who had walked and gone to second on a ground ball. Then, with a score 1-1 in the sixth inning, the Mets got a run in. They loaded the bases. Swan, the pitcher, comes up, and he gets his second hit of the game right between the pitcher's legs. Two runs come in, they get another one, and the score at the end was 5-2 Mets. Nice start.
Tonight, the Yankees continue their series against the Rangers at Texas. Game time right here on 11 Alive, 8:30. This afternoon, the Mets and Cubs continue their series at Shea Stadium. In the world of golf, first round of the Masters, the leaders are Ballesteros, Mitchell, and Graham with 66s. Two back, Jack Newton. Nicklaus shot a 74, so he trails by 8. Tom Weisskopf had a 13 on the 12th hole, hitting into the water 5 times. Turning now to the exclusive AccuWeather forecast for the next several days. Partly cloudy skies overnight with patchy, dense fog, the low around 50, drive with extra care overnight. Later today, lots of sunshine on tap for the metropolitan area, a balmy high around 62. Gray skies will move in on Saturday. There is the chance of a thundershower in the afternoon. 62 again is the predicted high. As for Sunday, periods of rain, the high near 60. Right now, it's 59 degrees under partly cloudy skies in Midtown. And that's Action News for Friday morning, the 11th of April. Weeknights, Pat Harper and Steve Bosch bring you Action News at 7:30. Bill Jorgensen joins Pat for a complete update at 10. I'm Roy Whitfield. Thank you for joining us, and do have a good day.
A recent WPIX editorial pointed out that a major cause of increasing health care costs in this country is the delay by government and insurance companies in reimbursing hospital claims. This forces hospitals holding past due accounts to borrow money at high interest rates, which of course significantly increases the hospital's expenses. Those who wrote to us in response to this editorial expressed concern over the reimbursement delays which fuel the nation's inflationary cycle. Harry H. Zucker, the legislative chairman of the Veterans Administration, Local 1151 of the American Federation of Government Employees, and Philip J. Kelly, the president of that organization, wrote that our editorial about the cash flow plight of the hospitals arising out of the government's failure to pay its bills promptly must be characterized as nothing less than an erudite analysis of a deplorable situation. They added, and I quote, Resolution of the problem, however, is not nearly as complicated as was suggested by your editorial. There is no reason why a special fund or bank cannot be established to discount the accounts owed by the government at a very nominal rate of interest. Thus, the squeeze would be obviated and funds would be readily available to the hospitals to assure continuity of service and avoidance of cash flow problems. And that ends that quote. Samuel R. Burns of Little Neck, New York, charged that the inability of hospitals to collect funds due has been going on for years, but it's only since government has become a large part of everyday life that it's being noticed. He continued, and I quote, "I suggest that Congress pass a law that government should have only a fixed period of time to pay their bills, and after that, interest be imposed on them. Also, that requests for payment be acknowledged within 5 days of receipt, and any reason for withholding of payment within 10 days. And that ends that excerpt. Those are some of the comments that our viewers have sent to us on the hidden costs in health care. We present them to you because we think you should know what your neighbors are thinking, and we urge you to continue to write to us about Wpix editorials.
If you are overweight and are looking for a way to reduce, we would like you to consider the Petri method of hypnosis.
I lost weight.
I lost weight.
I lost weight.
The Petri method is an original therapy of the New York Institute for Hypnotherapy. For information about how hypnosis may be able to help you lose weight, call 212-428-4372, 428-4372.
Stephen Boyd and Elke Sommer are part of an all-star cast of cutthroat actors competing for the most coveted award in the Oscars, Saturday night at 8 on 11 Alive.
August 5th, 1972, Senator John Tunney wrote in the Saturday Review, "Cloning, asexual laboratory duplication of frogs, has already been successful. The technology for the cloning of mammals will be available within 5 years. Unless research is stopped, the technology for the cloning of human beings might be available within anything from 10 to 25 years.
Yankee Sister, this is Echo Delta. Subject is descending to laboratory, over.
We copy, Echo Delta. Maintain surveillance.
you'll never see me again.